Hello, gentlemen. Good morning. First, thank you for attending this session today. We are going to discuss about automating security and compliance using OpenSCAP. I'm sure you might have heard about OpenSCAP earlier, but today we just need to know what's OpenSCAP, how it really works, why we need the standard for security and automating our system security standards. Security standards here means your compliance policies, your configuration, your batching. So this is what we are going to discuss today. So the agenda for this session today is, first we will start by discussing the SCAP in general. What's SCAP? And then we will need to understand what is a SCAP components. So even before discussing OpenSCAP, we need to understand the SCAP, because the SCAP is a standard. It's not only for Linux. It's for almost every kind of component in the IT world today. If you check other operating systems like Microsoft, like VMware, even networking and security devices like Cisco switches, routers, Juniper, Palo Alto, most of these companies now are offering SCAP content to make sure you are compliant to some security policy standards. So we need to understand first what is SCAP, and then we will start to deep dive about OpenSCAP, which is focusing on the Linux and Unix systems, specifically Red Hat for today. And then we'll discuss about the available tools in Red Hat products. We have a variety of products available, from scanning your local machine, to scanning a reborn machine, to automate the scan to multiple or even hundreds or even thousands of machines using Red Hat Satellite or Red Hat Cloud Forms. So we will try to scan today. Today is session part 1 of 2. In this session, we'll focus on understanding the concepts and scanning a single machine. And then on the next session, we will focus on automating this kind of scans to a group of machines. This group of machines could be from any number to almost thousands of machines, as you wish. And then we will discuss about the available tools and content, how to get this content, how to work with the SCAP content. Can I customize it? And at last, we will discuss about implementing this OpenSCAP. We want to see it in action, and we will do some demos to see how to use OpenSCAP and SCAP tools. Okay, first, the first question that we need to ask ourselves today, why we are here today? And why we are here, this is a very, very serious question. You should ask yourself this question almost every day about computer security. Everybody's talking about computer security. Okay, so computer security is becoming like, it's like a phobia for the people now. Everyone wants his environment to be secured. Okay, it's becoming increasingly important. So when we talk about computer security, there are two approaches available, and they are recognized in the computer security world today. The first one is proactive, and the second one is reactive. The proactive approach, it actually focuses on eliminating the problems before they occur. So if I know that there is a vulnerability available with the operating system, then I will immediately patch it before a problem happens and somebody attack my system. So this is a proactive approach. I will be proactive. I will try to fix the problems immediately once it's identified, before any problem happens. And the second approach is a reactive approach. Now, the reactive approach is usually is a sort of response. It is a react. You are reacting to some events that happened. Somebody already attacked your environment. Somebody was able to hack into some of your systems, or manipulate a specific vulnerability to gain a specific access that he is not supposed to have. Okay? So reactive approach is usually focuses on eliminating the threat and switching to alternate systems. One of the approaches for the reactive approach is, okay, these production systems are down. Okay, I have some backup systems and I will start using these backup systems immediately. Also, it focuses on investigation. We want to know how the attacker attacked our systems. And at last, it also talks about or focuses about remediation of compromised systems. So systems already hacked. Now what? How to remediate these systems? How to fix the problems? And how to make sure whoever attacked my systems will not be able to gain access again. Okay? So this is the two major approaches that are available with the computer security world today. Now, to continue to answer this question, this is a simple answer. We need to mitigate the consequences of possible attack. Okay? Now, we need to properly implement the security guidance. We need to have something standard. We need to apply this standard to all of our systems. Now, we need to harden our systems. Now, when we talk about 1 or 2 or 5 or 10 systems, it is easy to discuss this. But when we talk about hundreds or even thousands of machines, it is very, very difficult to handle this. That's the first problem. And second problem, as of today, when we discuss about security guidance or a security baseline or some security procedures, literally we have hundreds or even thousands of rules, and I can say it is a best practices that must be implemented to make sure the system is compliant with a specific security standard. So if you have these hundreds of rules and you are doing this kind of security hardening manually, your life will be like a nightmare. And trust me, I have tried this almost 15 years back. I was thinking about doing this, and automating such things, it is really a nightmare, because if you are implementing 100 rules, you might come and miss one rule in one of your servers if you are doing this manually. So the idea here, the objective for us, is to enable the user, is to enable the end users. End users here is our customers, to perform security audit on multiple remote systems from a single centralized environment. This is the major objective. This is our main objective of this webinar and the upcoming webinar. Now, to continue what we are saying, again, we need to have some sort of configuration management. Now, configuration management, it will allow us to ask this question: does your system configuration settings comply with a specific security policy? Second, vulnerability management. And vulnerability management here, it will allow us to detect and assign a specific priority or prioritize known vulnerabilities or software flaws on a specific system. And it will also allow us to determine whether it is appropriate or a specific patches must be applied to these systems. Okay. Third, which is system inventory. Now, we need to identify products installed on systems. Okay, so let's assume that scenario. I have a Linux system, a RHEL machine. This RHEL machine is running Oracle. Can I identify if Oracle is running here? This machine is running Java. Can I identify if Java is running here? Okay, this is the first question. Second question, what is the version of Java running? If I can identify the version and the software, then it will be easy for me to identify whether this software is suffering from a specific vulnerability or not. So we need some sort of a mechanism. We need a mechanism to allow us to get the system inventory. What is this system? What is this operating system? What is this version? What software are running, or what software is running on this machine? And what is the version of each software? If I can identify this, then it will be easy for me to mitigate any kind of risk. And also, it will allow us at last for malware detection. And this is really an evolving space. Malware detection here, it handles, or it is concerned with the presence of a malware on a system. And many solutions are available on the market now, but none of them offers 100%, because there is still zero-day vulnerabilities available. So some solutions, I have seen it, it is completely trying to record the behavior of the users and the applications. And if this behavior changes, then it will try to alert you, telling there is a problem going on here. And one very common example of this, let's assume we are talking about a user, and this is applicable for software services or software as well. So a user, he is coming every day. This user, once he comes to the work, he is grabbing a cup of tea or a cup of coffee, and he started browsing his emails. Then he started writing some documents. And then he started browsing the internet for news. And then after almost 30 minutes, he starts his actual work, like he's doing whatever he's doing, programming, office work, whatever. Now, this employee is coming every day. He's doing the same activity for the last 5 years. Now, what will happen if this employee is coming today, but he didn't do any of these activities and immediately will find a new activity happening on this machine or on this network? Like, like there is a file transfer on this network, or the user, he didn't do the actions he's doing every day. Then we have some possibilities here. Maybe he's the same user, maybe he's not the same user. And most probably, he will not be the same user, because people are programmed to do the same actions almost every day. Okay? So malware detection is still evolving space. Some software is available on the market, but none of them is achieving like the optimal or the best what we want to achieve as of today. We still didn't achieve this, but it's still evolving. Now, our next question. What is a SCAP? Before discussing OpenSCAP, we need to understand what is SCAP. Simply, when we talk about SCAP, SCAP is just a protocol. It is a security content automation protocol. Now, SCAP by itself, it is a set of standards. I can see around 7 or 8 standards today available. So we can name it as a super standard. Okay? So, a standard to detect the systems, a standard to detect the software running on the systems, a standard to find a specific configuration is applied or not, a standard to scan the systems, okay? And another standard to create reports about the status of these systems. So, this is actually what is a SCAP. So, it is a collection of standards. Each standard is responsible for a specific task. Okay, now SCAP is combining all of them into a single package. This package, we will name it as a SCAP protocol. Okay, this protocol is managed and maintained by NIST, a National Institute of Standards and Technology. Also for the SCAP, when we talk about SCAP, we are talking about different data formats. Okay, so a format to check the configuration, another format to give a score to this configuration. Maybe I have a system configured in such a way that it will allow remote users to log in without username and password. So is this configuration, what is the effect of this configuration? So we have a set of data formats here, multiple data formats. Now, the idea or the main problem for us is if we really want to use a SCAP, we must have the SCAP content available. It doesn't make sense to me or to anyone in the industry that everyone will need to develop his own standard. Okay? First, it's a time-consuming process. Second, what can we say about your standard? Is it the best standard? Is this the best rules available? Or somebody else has defined better rules? We will come to this later in a few seconds. Okay, back to our topic. Now, when we talk about SCAP, SCAP is actually have different formats available. The most available one is SCAP version 1.3. This was recently released, but 1.2 version is still the most widely deployed and used format as of today. Now, all SCAP formats are written on XML. So, regardless of which standard or which format you are using, all of them are written in XML. Okay? Okay. Now, do we actually need a standard? What a standard means? And the simple answer is, if you are really seeking to enhance your server security, this is actually the security that you will get if you don't have a standard. You will think you are secured, but actually you are not secured. Okay? Okay. Now, back to the question, why standards? Now, when we have a specific standard and everybody's using that standard, we will have a common understanding of what. Now, common understanding of what means, are we talking about same software vulnerability? Are we talking about same software vulnerability? Second, do we agree on what a policy recommendation means and how it meets or how this policy meets our needs? Also, common baseline for capabilities. Common baseline for capabilities, and this is really a difficult thing to achieve. Now, think about this scenario. Microsoft has its own tools. Red Hat has its own tools. Cisco has its own tools. IBM has its own tools. Google has its own tools. And each tool has its own capabilities. Imagine how much effort the content authors will need to spend on every tool to make sure this content can be used or this scab rules can be used with this tool. So we need a way. We need to standardize a way. When we develop a content, this content can run on any kind of tool, whatever who developed this tool. Okay? Third, we're talking about universal content. We need this content to be universal. Now, we need to be universal means here, like, we need to have a consistent understanding among all different people. So if this content is being used by organization X, it could be used by organization Y, it could be used by organization Z without any problems. Okay? Now, we need to establish a content repository, and this repository can be used by everyone. This content is universal for everyone. It's not for a specific use case. Okay? Now, last thing, which is tool compatibility, plug and play, and vendor neutrality. And this is really the most difficult thing among almost all kinds of standard, not only SCAB or open SCAB standard. And the idea or the problem that we are discussing about this point is due to the fact every vendor is trying to add a specific features to his own tool only. Okay, so still people are working on this, but some standards are available, like SCAB, for example. It's setting a specific rules and conditions that must be fulfilled by anyone who's writing SCAB content. Okay? Now, who's controlling and influencing SCAB? When we talk about SCAB, so we know that this standard was created and still maintained by NIST. Oh, it is not only NIST who's controlling and maintaining SCAB. This kind of SCAB rules and SCAB tools is not only created by NIST. Some other government organizations are involved, like NSA and Department of Homeland Security are also focusing and participating on this project. Other agencies available around the world, like agencies from everywhere. I can see or I can speak about US, UK, Australia. You will find many, for example, many standards created and developed only for a specific Australian government use cases. Okay, so this kind of standards, it's not only maintained by NIST, it is almost everyone is participating on it. Also some vendors, not some, I can say majority of big vendors, big names, are investing and doing a lot of research for SCAB standards, like Microsoft, Red Hat, Cisco, McAfee, Symantec, SANS Institute, Sun, if we're talking about Sun, that was a long time back, now it's Oracle, okay? And of course, Red Hat, one of the biggest investors on the SCAB protocol or SCAB standard. And at last, we are talking about community. Community means you, me, other people. Mailing lists around the internet are available. You can write or you can define whatever you want and you can write back to them. If it's approved, it will be enrolled into the SCAB standard for the next release. So this is how SCAB protocol or how SCAB standard is evolving over time. So many people are developing and researching, or many researchers are working to develop and maintain this standard and these rules. Now, to understand the SCAB and the standards that are used to make the SCAB. Now, we have some terms that we must understand. For example, enumerations. When we talk about enumerations, enumerations here are technically, they are just dictionaries. And they are used to identify a specific item. For example, I need to identify this device. Is it a router? Is it a switch? Is it a server? If it is a server, what operating system is running? Is it a specific software is running here? So we have enumerations. Enumerations will provide some sort of automated detection. It will detect. And also we have languages. Languages, it will allow us, it will guide us. It will guide us to create a specific security assessment or a specific security rules that we can use to scan our systems. Now, languages also will allow or will provide a structured and organization of what would otherwise be a narrative content, and it will help us to standardize and promote compatibility. Now, we will come and discuss about languages in a few seconds from now. Simply, languages will help us to define some rules that will allow us to scan the system or to scan systems and remediate them. That's it. At last, we have metrics. And metrics are just algorithms that can help us to rank the important or the importance of an item. Now, how this is important or why it is important? Because not all vulnerabilities should be treated like each other. Some vulnerabilities has high severity, or they are of high severity. Some other vulnerabilities are medium severity. Some other vulnerabilities are low. So the importance or the danger of keeping that vulnerability on the system will be variable according to this vulnerability itself, how it affects your system, how it can be allow, or how it will allow some users to compromise some systems. Okay, now let's start digging into these components one by one. The first one, enumerations. Enumerations, we have three enumerations available. The first one is CVE. Now, CVE, as I think most of you have already heard about CVE before, CVE stands for Common Vulnerabilities and Exposure. CVE will allow us to enumerate the software vulnerabilities. And this is known vulnerabilities. We have also CCE. It's Common Configuration Enumeration. It will try to find a specific configuration applied to that software. And we have CPE. And CPE, it is enumeration to identify the software and hardware entities. So this is our enumeration. This is what we should detect. We should detect vulnerabilities. We should detect a specific configuration. And we should detect a specific platform is running. Okay, second component, which is metrics. Metrics, we have Common Vulnerability Scoring System, CVSS. So CVSS is used as a metric, or it's a metric used to assign a severity score to vulnerability entries. We also have CCSS. So CCSS is used to assign a specific score to a specific configuration applied to that system. So two metrics available. First one is to assign a score to known system vulnerability or software vulnerability, and the other one to a specific configuration vulnerability or a weakness on that configuration. Maybe software is working fine, but you have configured it in such a way that would allow some kind of remote access. And at last, we have languages. Languages. We have four different languages available with a SCAB. The first one is XCCDF. And XCCDF, this is the most common the most common language used, or the most common standard used with a scan. So XCTDF, it is just a language. This language can allow us to encapsulate and structure the content of security guideline. We also have OVAL standard. As an OVAL standard, it is just a language to describe a specific test against a specific system state. So OVAL will be used to do actual tests. Okay? We also have OCIL. OCIL, it is an open checklist interactive language. And OCIL can get some questions or some can ask some questions and get some answers from the users. And at last, we have an ARF. ARF is asset reporting format. So ARF will be just a report that is generated as part of a scan process. So once I scan the system, I need to get a report. And this report could be, or usually it will be an ARF format. ARF format will be an XML. And that XML, it's a machine language. You can transfer it easily between different machines. You can use the ARF report to create a remediation using Ansible or Bash or Puppet. And I will show you how to do this during the demo. Now, let's start digging one by one. What is a CVE enumeration? So CVE, again, how CVEs really works, you will see it has a description. Here it is. It's describing in clear language, in clear English language, what's happening here. And also this CVE has a specific format. This format is a CVE ID, and it will be named as CVE dash. The name when this CVE or when this vulnerability was disclosed or known, and then a number to identify that vulnerability. And here is an example for the CVE 2009-10445, the description of it, and then some references available here. Now, CVE, again, it will be used to correlate vulnerabilities information. Okay, it is the most widely used. As of today, there is more than 139,000 CVEs available. And almost every week, more than 100 CVE are added. And these vulnerabilities across different platforms, across different vendors. Okay? Okay. Now, what about configuration? CCE, common configuration enumeration. CCE also will get a number, and this number will be named as CCE, and then a specific number available here. Number and then a checksum. So this number, here it is, 27905, and then a checksum of it. Now, the CCE, it will have this kind of format. So, a CCE description, and then the parameters, and then the technical mechanism, and then specific benchmarks according to a specific standards. What should happen here? Okay? And look at this, for example. This standard or CCE ID, according to CIS benchmark, it is stating that Apache configuration directory should be owned by the appropriate group. Here it is. Okay? Now, CCEs doesn't contain recommendation, it is policy neutral. And also CCEs, it doesn't map to just one way of controlling a configuration. It is procedure neutral. So whatever the way you will achieve this kind of configuration, it is not limiting you to use a specific tool or to do a specific implementation to reach to that state. You just need to have this in place. It really doesn't matter which kind of tool you are using. Okay? Also, CCE is platform neutral here. Each piece of software has its own list of CCEs. So if you have Apache and you have Tomcat, for example, or if you have Oracle and MySQL database, maybe each one of them will have its own CCEs. Okay? Okay, now, CCEs, it is mainly used to convey a universal understanding of what a policy configures. It also can be used to track recommendations against a specific configuration requirement. Now, when we talk about CCEs also, it can also be used to ensure policy comparison between equivalent recommendations. Okay, now CPE, and CPE is a very important part here. CPE, it has a descriptive URI. The CPE, which used to enumerate the platform itself, it will be on that format, CPE, colon, and then the part, and then vendor, product, version, update, edition, and at last the language. Now, for O for operating system, for this part, O for operating system, A for application, H for hardware. If you have some empty blocks here, this means it covers all values. So if you have a product, so if you have it defined like that, CBE colon, O colon, Microsoft colon, Windows XP, and then the version was missed, this means it applies to all Windows XP versions. Okay? So if you have some fields missing, this means it applies to all available versions in our example, or any update or any edition. Okay? Now, here is some examples. For example, Microsoft Windows XP or IBM Tivoli. So look at this. It will be CPE slash A. Slash A here, it means this is an application. And this application from IBM vendor, and this application, the product is Tivoli Configuration Manager, and the version of it is 4.2. Here it is. Okay? Now, again, just repeating this, CPE is used to automate software inventories and map platforms to vulnerability or policy statements. Okay. Now, back to our topic, back to our main topic, XCCDF language. We need to understand more about XCCDF language. Simply, XCCDF language is nothing more than a document format. It is a way to format your policy document, okay? To be able to author and execute some checklists to evaluate your systems. And this evaluation will be based on a specific defined criteria according to a specific checklist. So how it is really organized, it has a set of rules. These rules are recommendations. And we have some variables, okay, or some values. The values here are variables. For example, I need a configuration, or I need a specific directory to be owned by user httpd. So this will be my rule. So XCCDF is nothing more than a language. It's a language that will allow us to format the policy document in a specific manner to be able to author and execute this kind of checklists according to a specific policy. Here it is. Okay? Now, remember, we have some rules here and we have some values. Now, if we move immediately to OVAL, now, the OVAL language, it's actually used to check and to do tests, the actual tests that we need to do to first, to find vulnerabilities. Is this vulnerability present on our system? Also, to find some inventory measures and to do some batch detection, okay? Also, to do some automated scans. So, the OVAL language is doing the actual check. So, the actual tests is done by the help of the OVAL. Now, this is how the OVAL language is really working. So we have some definitions. We have some tests to do. This test will be applied to some objects. And these objects must be having this set of states. Okay? And you will see tests or sorry, the states are linked to variables. So objects and their states must have a specific variables. Here it is. Okay. Now, next, OCIL language. And simply, OCIL language, it used to query the user regarding non-technical policy recommendation. Okay. It can also be used to do manual collection of artifacts to provide evidence of a security posture. So, I want to get some input from the user to define a specific value. For example, I have NTBD service running, and this NTB service, I want to ask the user about a timeout. When the NTB service should be timeout if there is no response from the NTB server. I have SSH server running, and I want to timeout if there is no interaction from the user for the last 3 minutes. So, in this case, OCIL language is used to get this kind of answers, to ask these questions and get some answers from the user. Now, ARF format, and ARF is really one of the best things with a SCAP definition, because ARF, it will allow us to create or to generate a report based on a specific scan, and this report will be a machine language report. It's XML record. Okay, this XML record will allow us to use this report just to create rules to remediate systems after scan is completed. Okay, now after we finished all of these standards, we have talked about many standards. Now, you just need to understand that we have something called DS, or data stream. Okay? So, data stream is nothing more than a new file format, which was introduced by SCAP 1.2 specification. And the purpose of data stream is to bundle all of these standards into a single file. That's it. So if I want to have my policy, everything for that policy will be on a single file. I don't need to have a file to check for OVAL, and another file to check for CVEs, another file for CPEs, and so on. Now with a data stream file, I will have a single file, and that file combines all of them together. Okay. Now, data stream also supports digital signature, which will allow us to ship signed content in the future. Now, I can say this data stream file was created by Red Hat, and this means it was created by Red Hat. It has its own digital signature, so I can make sure it was really created by Red Hat, or it was created by Cisco, or it was created by Microsoft. So there was no way to manipulate these kind of files. Now, let's try to combine all of them together, putting all together. First, we have a checklist language. Then, we have instruction language, check instruction language, like OVAL and OCIL. And then, we have enumerations to scan systems for a specific vulnerability or a specific configuration, or to identify the platform itself. Also, we have risk measurement. We need to ensure, or what is the score of this risk? Okay? By the way, the score is from 0 to 10. 0 or 10 is the highest, risk. 0 is the lowest risk available. And also, we have reports. By the way, reports can be created in multiple formats. ARF is the most common format, but you can create the traditional XML format, not ARF. And also you can create HTML record. HTML record will be usually for human being readability. If you want to read that report in such a way that you can understand it as a human, you can create HTML report. Now, how all of them work together? Look at this. So, we are defining the checklists using XCCDF, and then we are doing actual checks and actual queries using OVAL and OCIL. XCCDF also will interact with the CCE and CBE. OVAL will try to scan for CVEs. And according to these scans together, according to these enumerations, a score will check for the score according to your configuration and your current vulnerabilities or available vulnerabilities. And all of them together will work to create a comprehensive report in something called ARF format. Now we know that SCAP is just a super standard that combines multiple standards. Standards for enumerations, standards for language, standard for metrics. Now, what is OpenSCAP? We keep hearing about OpenSCAP. So OpenSCAP is nothing, or it is just a framework of libraries and tools to improve the accessibility of SCAP content. Now, OpenSCAP, it's composed of multiple components. It is mainly a library. So OpenSCAP, it's a library that provides an API to scan document processing and evaluation. Also, it has a toolkit. This toolkit is a set of tools. These tools are just, it will allow us to just scan the systems through command line or through graphical interface. Okay, to find a configuration, a specific configuration for vulnerability scanning, for content validation and transformation. Okay, now, which tools are available for SCAP? Now, we are using OpenSCAP, or we will use OpenSCAP. So what the tools are available? Now, we have the OpenSCAP itself. OpenSCAP is just, again, it is open source tools and libraries. Now, the scanners which we have command line tools for configuration and vulnerability assessment. Okay, and we have many tools to scan local and remote hosts. We also have a GUI tool which is called SCAP Workbench. SCAP Workbench is a GUI tool that will allow us to scan and tailor the content. Tailor the content here means customize the content. We also have SCAP Security Guide. SCAP Security Guide is a project that provides pre-built profiles for common configuration requirements, such as PCI, STIG, and so on, and C2S. Now, other tools available for SCAP, okay? Other tools like OpenSCAP Anaconda or OSCAP Anaconda. So OSCAP Anaconda is just an extension. It's an add-on to the Anaconda installer that can allow you to apply security policy, to feed that security policy during the installation process. And this will help you to ensure that your systems are compliant from day one. Okay? So this should be something that you might be looking for. So instead of applying the policies after operating system is installed, you can just apply them directly while you are installing the operating system. We have also Red Hat Satellite, and Red Hat Satellite, it provides a centralized mechanism and a lifecycle management with enterprise vulnerability scanning measurements. The Satellite or Red Hat Satellite, it can allow us to upload our SCAP content, our SCAP profiles, and use it to automate the SCAP scanning and remediation using Puppet or Ansible. Just I want you to keep in your mind that Puppet will not be supported on Satellite 6.8. So the current release of Satellite is 6.7. With the upcoming release of Satellite 6.8, Puppet will not be supported. So if you are looking for Red Hat Satellite automation of SCAP, it should be, or you should be focusing on Ansible automation. Okay. By the way, with the OpenSCAP, you can create remediation either based on Bash or Ansible or Puppet. All the three are available and you can use of them. But specifically to Satellite case, Satellite can support automating them using Puppet or using Ansible, but you should be focusing on Ansible, as Puppet will not be supported with the next release. Also, you can automate, we can automate your security scanning using Red Hat Cloud Forms, and you can do this for hybrid clouds, public and the private clouds. And one example here, do you really want to scan Amazon AMIs? So you can do this directly from Red Hat Cloud Forms. Now, some utilities, we have a package called OpenSCAP Utils, which will provide some utilities to us. These utilities will allow us to scan container images. Okay, so if you are using RHEL and you are familiar with RHEL, Red Hat stopped using Docker starting from RHEL 8, and Bodman is a default container runtime available right now. So if you want to scan Bodman images, we have OpenSCAP Utils. OpenSCAP Utils, it will provide OSCAP-Bodman utility, and this utility is available from RHEL 8.2. Okay, now the next question, how to get and use SCAP content? Now, I know that there is a project called OpenSCAP. This project has a set of tools and a set of libraries available. Okay, how now can I get the policies? How I can get the policies now? Now, the SCAP Security Guide project. The SCAP Security Guide project is already providing a practical security hardening advice. Okay, so the content, you can get it from SCAP Security Guide project. This project is sponsored by Red Hat. Okay, and it will allow us to get tools and content. Content here means data stream files. This data stream files contain the actual policies that we need to implement. Now, this project was implemented in 2011 as a collaboration between US government and Red Hat. And as of today, this project provides policies for RHEL 6, RHEL 7, and RHEL 8. And there is also some policies available for JBoss application server, Java, Webmin, Tomcat, Apache. Some of them are pending, and I can see some of them already completed as of today. Now, the purpose of this project was to take the policy requirement and present them in a machine readable format. So policies are usually created in a plain text. It's English language, something that you can understand, but applying them to the machine may be requiring a specific XML format, or if you want to remediate problems, you need to create a specific bash script to remediate it, or a specific Ansible playbook, or a Puppet module. Then the SCAP Security Guide is concerned with getting all these requirements, getting all the policy requirements, and translate these requirements into a readable format, or to a machine readable format. Okay, in other words, it will provide you with a data stream file that combines all of the standards we discussed a few minutes back. Now, some tools worth mentioning here, like SCAP Workbench. SCAP Workbench is a graphical user interface tool, and this graphical interface tool can allow you to scan a local and or remote system. Okay? SCAP Workbench can scan a single machine. Again, if you want to automate a group of machines, then you need to go for Red Hat Satellite or Red Hat Cloud Forms. Now, what I can scan using OpenSCAP, what exactly I can scan? To answer this, simply, we can use OpenSCAP tools to scan a local machine, or we can scan a remote host, or we can scan a virtual machine image, and at last we can scan a container. Okay, how to use it? Now, to use it, simply, you need to specify the tool name, okay? And then, which format? Are you using XCCDF format or OVAL format? And the operation, Operation is usually eval. Eval means evaluation. I want to evaluate that system. I want to scan it and find what's going on. You need to specify the profile. We'll talk about profiles. You will see it in a few minutes. And then we can specify the results file in HTML format. We can also specify ARF file. We can specify a report. And at last, we need to specify a data stream file. An example to scan a local machine. We can use OSCAP command. And we are using XCCDF format. We would like to evaluate. And based on this evaluation will be based on that profile. Here it is, which called STIG REL 7 server upstream. And I want to save the results into XML file. And I want to save another copy of the results, but in ARF format. So this is generic XML format. This is ARF XML format. And I can create a report in HTML, so I can navigate it and see what is the result. And at last, I need to specify the data stream file. Here it is. Okay? Okay. Same we can do for a virtual machine. But for a virtual machine, you can specify the virtual machine domain if the machine is already defined in libvirt, or you can specify a VM image file. And here it is. Look at this. I can specify the virtual machine image file, or I can specify the domain. Okay. To scan a Bodman container, now you have two ways to do it. The first way is you can scan the container while it is running. If your container is running, you can use OSCAP-Bodman and then specify container option. Here it is. And you have to specify the container ID and the same syntax. The profile, or sorry, you need to do evaluation using XCCDF format. And here is a profile. And this is our data stream file. That's it. Or you can scan an image. Okay? So you can specify the image ID and you can scan it as well. So whether your container is running or you want to scan an image, you can do both scanning using OSCAP-Bodman. The only difference is the sub option container or image. That's it. Okay, now enough talking now. Let's get hands dirty. Now let's try to go to the command line and try to see what's going on. Now, to do this, I need to first launch some virtual machines here. So I have RelA.2 machine running here. I will try to clone it. Here we are, clone. So I will use this virtual machine to scan some remote hosts. Let me try to do one thing. I would like to create a new virtual machine. So let me do it. We'll start from scratch. So this is REL 7.7 machine running. Let's give it some more memory. Let me create an image file here. So let me go to my terminal. Image is libvirt, and I can use kemu-image create, and I will create a new file. I will name it as rel7.7-oscap. Here it is. Now, let me go back here. I want to select that file. Here we are. Now forward I will name it as OSCAP dash client. Let's start doing the installation. This machine which I will use, the other machine, let me log into it. So I have an IP address 232. Okay, great. Let me continue the installation of this machine. So installation destination, I will select it. I will configure partitioning. I will select this manually. I don't want to have a separate home partition. I will go for a very simple setup. This is the simplest setup ever possible. I will change my time zone. So I'll try to do like a minimal setup here. That's it. So I will also want to connect the network. A software selection is minimal server install. You can choose server with GUI, of course, but I don't want to have this. Now, begin installation. Now, I will set a password for the root account. And let the installation complete. Now, I will go to here to my terminal. Now SSH to root at 192.168.122.232. And this is my machine. Here it is. You know what? I will do one thing. I will do one thing. I will create a new machine from scratch just to show you all the steps. So here we are. So I have this one, I will clone it and I will name it as OpenSCAP Scanner. And I have my OpenSCAP scanner machine. It's also running. This is a minimal OS install, nothing installed on it. So it is a clean machine. It's just minimal installation, nothing else. Here we are. So I have this machine, it's IP address 16. Okay, great. So first I will do regular registration. Okay, this machine is registered. Next step, I will attach this machine to the default repositories. So I will try to use auto attach here. So I can use subscription manager attach dash dash auto. Let me open a new terminal as well. So I have two machines now. The first one, this will be the scanner machine. I will scan from here. The second one, this will be my client, which will be scanned. So SSH root at 192.168.122. And this is my OpenSCAP client. It's about to complete. Let's wait for a second. Okay, great. This machine now is subscribed. Okay, now this machine is subscribed. The first thing I will do now is I will try to install some tools. I will try to install SCAP scanner. Okay, I will try to install SCAP security guide to be able to fetch the policies. So what I can do is let's try to use dash y option install. I would like to install, let's say, bash completion. I also want to install vim, net tools, and I would like to get some OpenSCAP tools now. So I can use OpenSCAP, OpenSCAP scanner, OpenSCAP dash utils, and SCAP security guide. This will pretty much cover almost everything I need to do to perform a scan from any kind of a scanner. I don't need this anymore. Now my client still waiting for it to complete. Okay, so this machine, I will name it, I will give it any name like Bastion or Scanner, so I can do this. No need for this, I'm already root, so I can use host name control set host name scanner.example.com. Just to be able to differentiate between them. Let me log out and re-log in again. And that's good. So my scanner machine is ready. I'm just waiting for the client machine. Now, while client machine is still installing, let me show you a few things. First, let's go to user share XML directory. In this directory, a new directory already created for scap. So cd scap security guide. And we have content. So look at this. In this directory, all the scap content that's coming from scap security guide project will be available. If we want to check it, here it is. Here we are. So we have some data stream files available for RHEL 8. We have some data stream available for RHEL 6. We have data stream available for, should be for RHEL 7 somewhere here. Yes, here it is. And you'll find the version of scap here, 1.2. So usually we will use one of these files. Okay, so let me try to do this. OSCAP, and I can use info for this file, for example. And let's use less-r to see the output on a good way. Now, here it is. I want to display the information about this data stream file. So this is source data stream. If you remember, I told you source data stream is just a way to combine all these standards into a single file, to package all these standards into a single file. And here we are. Now, this is a stream file. It's compatible with which version, what kind of a checklist is available, and look at the profiles. Let me minimize the font a little bit. Now, look at the current profiles available. With this profile for RHEL 7, this data stream file for RHEL 7, it has almost 17 profiles available. If you count them, you will find them around 17 profiles. So, a profile for HIPAA, another profile for NIST, another profile for OSPB, a profile for Red Hat Corporate, a profile for PCI DSS, a profile for STIG. So multiple profiles available. You can choose any of them based on your requirement. Okay? Okay. Now, when you try to use a profile, you will use a profile ID. You will not use a profile title. You will use a profile ID. And this is what we are going to do in a few minutes. Okay. Now, let's check our client. It should be completed. Yes, it is. Now, let's go back here. I want to choose any profile. Let's choose some custom, or let's try to use any profile here. For example, PCI is one, Red Hat Corporate is one. It's any of them. There is Australian C2S, Australian Cybersecurity C2S profile also. We have a standard system security profile. Let's try to use this. We have some profile available here. Let's try to use it. Okay, so how to use it? Simply, I'm going to scan a remote host. So to scan it, I can use oscap-ssh. And I will connect using root at 192.168.122. Let's find the IP here. IP address show, and my IP is 209.209. Now, 209. Let's connect to this machine as well. connected to this machine. Perfect. Now, I want to connect to this machine using SSH, and this is my user, and the SSH is running on port 22, and I want to do XCCDF scanning, and I want to do evaluation, okay? And the profile that will be used is the profile we just copied. Here it is. And I want to create a report. I will name it as client-report.html. And I can save the results of this scanning into an ARF results file. So I can use results-arf, and I will name it as maybe arf.xml or client-arf.xml. I can specify some options like fetch remote resources. This option will try to copy back these generated files from the client machine. So what will happen is OpenSCAP will transfer the data stream file. By the way, I missed to specify the data stream file. It is in user share XML OSCAP or XML SCAP SSG content. It is an SSG rel 7 DS, if I'm not mistaken. Yes, DS-1.2. Yes, here it is. So what will happen is the OpenSCAP SSH will copy that profile to the client machine here, and then once the scan is completed, it will try to collect back these files to the scanner machine. Okay, so it will copy them back. Now, just for your information, this is a very important piece of information. The SCAP scanner must be available on the client machine. Even SCAP SSH is connecting remotely to the client machine, you still need the SCAP scanner to be available on the client machine. No question about that. Okay? So what I will do here is I'm also going to subscribe it. Subscription manager register. Okay, on the client machine, you don't need the SCAP security guide. You don't need the SCAP utils. You just need the SCAP scanner. That's it. Okay? And this is what we're going to do now. Now, subscription manager attach --auto. And I'm almost done here. Just need to install the package. One thing that I can do to make sure I'm working cleanly, I can use mkdir, for example, work. And then I can execute this command from that directory, because it's going to collect some files from the remote machine. So instead of keeping them directly into my home directory, I want to keep them in a specific directory. Here I named it as work. Okay. So what I can do is yum install OpenSCAP dash scanner. And here we are. Installation is completed. Now it's time to do a scanning to this machine. It's time to scan this machine. So let me try to connect to this machine. I'm specifying the password. Now look at this. It started transferring the data stream file to this machine using SSH automatically, and evaluation has started. If you checked here on this client machine what's going on behind the scenes, now look at this. The OpenSCAP scanner has started. Now, if you noticed something, when you run OpenSCAP, look at this probing system. Look, it started to do some operations to probe file, to probe your system. Probe means scanning your system to find out what's going on in the system. What kind of software you have? Do you remember CPE, Common Enumeration or Common Platform Enumeration? It will also start to verify what software running. It will try to find your RBMs installed. So actually what will happen is it will start to find out what's going on in that system. What kind of system is this? Everything about it, software installed, what kind of configuration you have, it's everything. Everything means everything. And back to our server, it started now to do some checks. Some checks, you will see it. This check has a title according to that rule, and this check has this identity number, and the result of doing that check has passed. Pass means yes. It is compliant to that policy. So the results can be either passed or failed, or it's something we are calling it as not applicable. Okay? Now, I need you to notice one thing also here. Look at the load on that system. This system is basically free. It's not doing anything. But once I started the scanning process, the load on the system was increased. It is dramatically increased. Okay? And this you should keep in your mind. If you have hundreds of machines or thousands of machines, if you have a large virtual environment, don't ever try to scan all of them together. Okay? So this is very important for you. When you scan machines, when you scan some machines, don't ever try to scan them together, especially virtual environments. Otherwise, you might end up with a very high CPU utilization for all your virtual machines all together at the same time, which might affect the performance of the overall infrastructure. Now, look at this. This, for example, this test, it was failed. Here it is. So, some of them will be pass, some of them will be fail. So, for the pass tests, yeah, that's fine. But some of them are already failed. Okay, now, the next step, I will try to show you how to use the ARF report to create a remediation script, okay, or a remediation Ansible playbook, whatever we can do in Udemy. Okay, now look at what happened. After scanning was completed, it was using copying back. Copying back was used because, or copying back was utilized because I used fetch remote resources. Here it is. Okay? Okay, now I should be able to see some files created. Okay, let me move client --asterisk to work, cd work. Now I have these files available. Now let's try to navigate this report. Let me try to do one thing. This is my local machine. mkdir /scan cd scan. Now scb we have 16 here. We need to use -r option. And here we are, ls. Okay, cd work. Let's try now to find what's in that file. Now, I can use Google Chrome, for example, for client report.html. Now, this is the report, this is the HTML report generated from doing the scanning. Now, look at this. The result is 20 check has passed and 31 failed. And two of them has high severity, 28 of them has medium severity, and one of them is low severity. And here is the actual results for all of them. Now, if you try to open any of the failed tests or failed checks, for example, record events, here it is. So this is the role ID and when this check was performed, severity, identifiers, and look at this. To mitigate it, you need to apply these rules. Here it is. Okay. Now, if you want to remediate this, you can remediation shell script, show it. It will automatically create a shell script, which you can take it as copy paste and run it on that host. Here it is. Look at this. Okay. So you really don't need to spend time and effort to do this. Now, you have two options, actually. You have two options. The first option is to create a remediation script, maybe a bash or Ansible or Puppet, from the result ARF file. Here it is, client ARF. If you try to use this, client arf.xml or cat. Look at this, it is nothing more than an XML file we have. Look, this is the result of the scanning that happened on your machine. So I can use this file to create a remediation rules for the failed tests only, not for everything. Now, to do this, I can use OSCAP. I'm using XCCDF. And I can use generate fix. And the fix type, whatever you want. We have bash, we have Ansible, we have Puppet. So I can use Ansible, for example. This is just an example here. And I want to generate a fix for a specific result. If you want a specific result, you can get the result. Look at the result where it is for this rule. I want to create it for this rule. Okay? Now, if you want to specify for all of them, you just need to keep it empty like that. Here it is. Now, this will generate for all of them. And I can use the output option. The output option, it will allow me to specify which file I need to write this playbook. I can say remediation-playbook.yaml, automatically generated. Okay, and this is coming from client arf.xml file. Now, once this command is executed, it will automatically generate an Ansible playbook, which you can use later to fix all problems on that server. Now, if you try to use cat, I named it as remediation playbook. Look at this. Automatically, Ansible playbook generated from evaluation of standard system security profile. And here it is. This is a command we used. And this is the rules. Or this is the Ansible playbook that was automatically created for us. You don't need to spend any time or effort. Here we are. Okay, so this is one option. Another option we have, when you scan the server, so if you remember, okay, mkdir work2, cd work2, same command which we used, here it is, but instead of eval, I will use another option next to it, which is remediate. Okay, so now it will try to evaluate and remediate the risks now. Here it is. Now, this time, it will try to fix the problems. Anything that's not compliant to the policy, it will try to fix it. Okay, now there is something important that I need you to realize, which is maybe your policy stating that I have a rule that's saying you must have var log should be on a separate partition, but in your scenario we don't have var log on a separate partition. So in that case, the remediation script will not try to attempt to do something that might harm your system. So this will be left to the end user, to the customer, to create this manually. Okay? So some rules, OpenSCAP will try to avoid or will avoid implementing them. Okay? Now, let's go back here. Let's start again, probing file, running OpenSCAP, probing RBM. Now look at this, some of them already fixed, here it is. When you see fixed, this means a remediation has been implemented to avoid this weakness or this vulnerability. Or a policy element was not there and it started to be available once fixing has completed. Now, let me go back to my machine here. Now I will try to secure copy these files again one more time. I'm going to copy work to directory once scan is completed. This is the first attempt of the scanning. Now, if you notice something here, part of the policy scan, it was about ensuring you have the latest updates. Look at this. So Yum now is running on the background to ensure you have the latest packages installed on that machine. Now, you need to realize the fact that you will get the policy as it is. So in some situations and according to your needs, you will certainly need to customize that policy. So maybe the policy or as a data stream file, which you downloaded for SCAB is stating that you must have separate slash user local partition, separate slash var log partition, separate partitions for different purposes. You need to have the latest packages, but if you install the latest packages, this may cause a conflict with another software. So maybe you need to install only specific packages that are known to mitigate some specific risks. Okay? So certainly you will need to customize these policies. So policies are coming as it is. In most cases, you will need to customize these policies to accommodate or to maintain a specific need for your environment. And this is the next exercise that we are going to do. Now look at this, Yum is running in the background. If I go to this machine, this is my client machine here. Now, let me try to use tail var log yum.log. Certainly I should be able to see something, yes. Look at this, Yum is updating something now in the background. Here it is. It is generating a new initRD using Dracut. Here it is. Some other work in the background, gzip, cbio. Okay, let's keep it running on the background. Now, just to save the time, there's one thing I want to show to you, which is user share scab security guide. Scab security guide, we have kickstart directory. Let me go here. Now, you will find pre-configured Kickstart profiles available, which you can use to automate the security policy during the installation of your Linux system. If you opened it, if you opened any of these files, cat, for example, let's try to RHEL 7 PCI server with UI. This is just an example, okay? So it's just a normal kickstart file, nothing significant here, just doing installation. It's setting the language, the keyboard, the network, the root password, firewall, auth config, and the bootloader password as well. Zero MBR, just to wipe or to clear everything on that disk. And then creating a specific partition, here it is, creating a volume group, a PV. Now here we are, look at this. So we have a separate slash temp, separate slash var, separate var log, separate var log audit. So this is a policy requirement. Okay, so this is a policy requirement. Now, the most important thing here is this statement, add-on. And in this add-on, the profile is configured. Here it is. Okay? So, if you want to apply OpenSCAP during installation, if you want to apply security policy for OpenSCAP during installation, you can just use this, or you can use any of these files as your template. You can customize it, customize the partitioning, customize software. So you can use these Kickstart files as a base template for your Kickstart or for your automatic Kickstart installation. Okay? Now, let's go back here to the terminal and see what happened. It's still running. Now, it's ensuring some software batches installed. Let's try to do something interesting. Var www.html on my host. I don't have anything here. So let me try to do this. CB. I want to do RHEL 7. Let's try to do RHEL 7 with UI. I want to copy this to var www.html. And for sure I need to use sudo. Sudo chown. First, let's check lsh var www.html with dash d. Okay, let me do this. Okay, so I don't have HTTP package installed. Okay, yum, install httpd. Okay, cat etc password, the name is called Apache. Okay, that's my mistake. It's called Apache. Chown Apache, colon Apache. To var www.html-r. Now what I can do is system control, just I want to make sure it's up, restart httpd, system control status httpd. Now it's active running. Now my next step, I want to do automated system installation using OpenSCAP profile. So var www.html, I want to give this file a short name. So I want to move it mv, that file, to ks.cfg. That will be easier. And my IP address is 122.1. Okay, great. Okay, this also is completed, which is a good news. Now let's check the comparison between the first scan and second scan after remediation. So cd/temp scan. So I need to do this scb-r. The IP was 16 root at 192.168.122.16 from /root work2 to my current working directory. lscd work2, and it's time now Google Chrome. CD Google Chrome for client-report.html. Now let's see the difference between both of them. Now look at this. The first scan result, I had 31 failed check and 20 check passed. Now with the second check, 48 passed, 2 failed, and 1. This one means, here it is, not applicable, or it cannot be performed. Now look at this. The failed checks, it will be something that you must intervene. It requires user intervention, manual intervention. For example, here it is. Ensure var log audit on a separate partition. Okay? So you need to create a partition for this. So in that case, some operations will require a manual intervention, but most of it, I can say 99% of it, it doesn't require any kind of manual intervention. Okay, and by the way, not all organizations will require this policy. That's why you will need to customize it. Okay, now you can see what is the effect before remediation and after remediation. Here it is. See the difference. Okay, now let's try to apply a policy while installing a machine. So let me close this. I want to create a new virtual machine here. That's local install media, it is rel 7 as well. Forward 4096. Forward create a 10 gig disk, that's fine. I will name it as OS install OpenSCAB, and let's connect to default network. Now back to here. For www.html, and I have my KS file, so cat ks.cfg. Okay, now I need to modify that file for only one parameter, which is do the installation from CD-ROM. I'm just specifying the URL where is all files are located. Okay, now that should be enough. Now it's time to install that system. Now let me try to give you a better view. Okay, now I will just press tab and I can use Linux ks kickstart equal to http 192.168.122.1, and it is located on a file called ks.cfg. Let me try to grab that file first. Let me try to grab it from here. Okay, I have curl http 192.168.122.1 ks.cfg just to make sure. Sorry, I have a typo mistake here. Or let's try to use wget. Okay, yum install wget-y. I just want to make sure that I'm able to connect and fetch that file. Okay? No route to host. IP address show. So 192.168.122.1/ks.cfg. IP route. Okay, it cannot fetch this from the gateway because it is a gateway, right? So it's doing NAT. Okay, now I understand what is the problem. So what I will do, yum-y, install httpd. So I cannot fetch the file from the gateway because it is doing nothing. Okay? So let's try to install Apache on one of these servers. Okay? Okay, now I will try to do copy user share scap security guide. User share, I don't have it. Do I have it here? Should be. No, I don't have it here. I don't have scap security guide. It's only installed on the scanner. Okay. yum-y install httpd. It will work. So what I can do is copy user share scap security guide kickstart. I want to get it for L7 PCI. I want to copy it to var www.html system control restart httpd. System control enable httpd. Also, I need to allow this through the firewall. Firewall cmd --- add service httpd http, and I want to make this permanent. Now cd var www.html, and this is my file mv that file, and I will name it as ks.cfg. I'm almost done. Now I just need to open the file vimks.cfg, and I need to modify the CD-ROM parameter. That's it. ls-l. Okay, now chown apache colon apache to ks.cfg, And I'm almost done. Now, I need to check here from dot 16, wget from 16, ks.cfg, I was able to fetch it, less ks.cfg, yes. Now I can do my installation without any problem. So I can get this ks file, kickstart file, from 192.168.122.16, ks.cfg, and I can press enter. Now it should be able to fetch it without any problem. Now you will see, since it's the very beginning of the installation of that file, since the beginning of the installation of this operating system, this file was fetched, and it will apply the OS installation according to this kickstart, which is stating that my security profile is this specific profile. Okay? Now, this will allow you to ensure that you are complying with the policy since the very beginning of the operating system installation. Okay, now I only have something failed, which is, it's not related to the installation. It's not related to the installation. It is related to the disk selected, to the selected disk. Check it. Okay, fine. I'm most probably, this is because, let's check that file, catks.cfg. So this is most probably because the file or the disk was not specified. Okay, now look at this. You will notice one thing here I didn't select, which is security policy. Here it is. It's telling everything okay. This means your security policy was already selected. Now, begin installation. Maybe we can check that file and find vimks.cfg. We don't have vim here. Let me go back to my machine. Let's try to find out which disk it's using. By the way, there is one thing that we need to check here, which is, if you are customizing that file, also you will need to set up the root password. The root password is by default is called server. And what else? Yeah, so you can have system config kickstart utility and you can customize that file. So look at this. Installation will start and it will continue in the background. So let's keep it running. Now, last thing, which is customizing the policy. You have seen that we have policies pre-built. We don't need to spend time and effort to customize any kind of policy if you want to stick with the policy itself. But this is not the case for most of your work. In most of your systems, sometimes you will need to have your own rules. You need to specify a specific rules and conditions. Now, for this, you will need to customize the policy. To customize the policy, we have a tool called Scab Workbench. For this Scab Workbench, it will try to dig into user share Scab directory and find which profiles available for which operating systems. Look, I have profiles for L6, 7, and 8. I have also for Firefox and GRE. Okay? By the way, there are many data streams available even for Windows. You can download them and you can use this tool to scan Windows systems itself. Okay? Okay, now let's try to select FreeRTEL 7 for example, and I will try to use loot content while this is running. Let's keep it running in the background. Now, this is the SCAP content. Now, look at the profile here. This is the profiles which we have seen a few minutes back. Do you remember? FreeRTEL 8, I told you there is almost 4 profiles available as of today. FreeRTEL 7, there is 17 profiles available. And you will find the profile and the number of rules or number of attributes associated with it. Each one of them or each rule of them has some attributes to configure specific policies. So let's try to select this, for example. This is the biggest one. This is the longest one. Now, it will try to configure all of these rules. But in reality, you might not need to make sure, for example, a var temp on a separate partition or no SUID on that partition. Okay? Maybe you don't need to install AIDE or Advanced Intrusion Detection Scanner. Maybe you don't need to enable ODD. I don't know what's your requirement. So you should specify your requirement, like remove RSH trust files, disable RExec service, disable RLogin service. So many of them are available, but do you really need some of the policy requirement is requiring you to disable Samba? But maybe in your environment, you need Samba to be available. Okay, nobody knows, truly. So most probably, you will take one of these profiles and you will need to customize it. So you can customize this profile. Press customize. It will ask you what should be the name of the customization for that profile. You need to keep in your mind that there is a format for the profile name. The profile ID must have a specific format. Okay? And this format is xccdf underscore reverse DNS underscore profile underscore rest of the ID dot and then, sorry, rest of the ID, and then you can add your IDs here. So we can modify this as my custom profile. Press OK. And it will open now an editor to allow you to customize this profile. Now, you will notice few things. Few things that has a check mark. If you need to check mark, this means it is on or off variables, or it's on or off setting. And there is settings that has this tool in front of them. Okay? This tool means you can modify this value. It has some values that can be modified. Okay? So you can select whatever rules you need. So I can deselect all, and then I can specify which rules I need to apply. For example, use only strong ciphers for SSH. Disable SSH support for our hosts. Use only strong max. Use FIPS 140-2. Disable SSH root login. Enable SSH warning message. Enable SSH print last log. So I need to enable these settings only, nothing else. Okay? Once I finish this, I just need to press OK. So select the rules you want to apply. So this is exactly what you need to apply. So this is what's called as tailoring. We are customizing the profile. Once you tailor the profile, you can use File, Save Customization, and it will ask you where you want to save it. Give it a name. Here it is. Okay, now if we try to check this tailoring file, here Here it is, less SSG. So this is my customization only, not everything on that file. Now, when you start scanning the system, next time you start scanning that system, you just need to provide that tailoring file for your next scan, okay? And how you can do this is simply, let me try to copy that file. So it's called ssg-rel7. Okay, secure copy. I want to copy it to root at 192.168.122.16 to / root. Now if I go back here to this machine, I have copied this tailoring file. You remember when I was doing scanning and fixing? Same command I used for scanning and fixing. Here it is. Here it is. I can specify the tailoring somewhere here. So this is my profile. Okay. So I specified the profile. Now I can use --tailoring, T-A-I-L, tailoring --file. And I can specify that file. It is a root SSG, that file. Now, when I'm trying to scan now or remediate risks, it will not scan for everything. It will not remediate everything. It will only try to scan and remediate whatever I have provided. That's it, nothing else. Now, look at this, this time. Let's check the installation here. It's about to complete. How the tailoring is actually working, it is trying to set, look at this. It's only selecting a specific part from an already existing policy. So here it is. As you can see on that file, on that tailoring file itself, for the rest of the policies, it's selecting as false. And for the policies which I enabled, it's selected as true. So when you try to connect, it will try only to check the items which you specified as true. But the rest, no, it doesn't concern itself with the rest. So this is the way how you can create a tailoring file. Now, if you are using Red Hat Satellite, you can also create this tailoring file. You can upload the data stream file, and you can upload your tailoring file, okay, your customization. So you can upload the profile and the customization. And you can scan some systems according to a specific policy which you have. Okay? Okay, by the way, you can use this, or you can use this Scab Workbench tool to scan a local machine or to scan a remote host. And if you want to scan a remote host, you need to specify the username. Here it is. Okay, now you can start scan. Also, It will start scanning and show you from the graphical interface. Also, you can create generate remediation rules, like what we did earlier. Okay? And here it is. You can create remediation rule directly from the graphical interface. Now, let's check it. Now, if you noticed, this time, the remediation rule is only for the rules I specified. The total lines on that file, 258 lines only. It's 258. But if you are talking about the complete policy, now, look at this. The complete policy. If I have the complete policy available, generate an Ansible or Bash script, trust me, it will be thousands of lines. So, look at the complete policy remediation. Now we are talking about 11,000 lines available with this policy only. Okay? Now, this should have been completing now. Anyway, it's completed. And once system is booted, it will be compliant with your policy. So you have multiple options available. The first one is to do the automation while you are installing the operating system itself. You can do security policy automation, selecting a specific security policy at the time of the installation. Second, you can scan and customize, you can scan and remediate while systems are running. Third, you can customize the policy and you can use it to scan and remediate hosts. Okay? Whatever the tool you are using, whether you are doing it from the command line or from the graphical interface, personally, I prefer the command line. Specifically, because with the command line, I can save the ARF format report. And this file, I can use it to create remediation rules. Okay? Okay. Back here. So this is the scenarios which we have discussed. Before I end up this session, do you have any questions for today? Okay, how Satellite deals with some questions. Okay, what I will do is I will try to share a Google Sheet file with you. You can write down all your questions, all your queries. And I will respond back to them. But to answer a question while we are here, simply, you can create multiple host groups. And then these host groups, you can scan them according to your policy. And when you deal with Satellite, you can specify a specific interval to run these or to run this policy checks. So simply, you can say to Satellite, or you can tell Satellite, I would like to run this policy check every week, for example, or every week around 12 or around 1 a.m. Every Friday or every Saturday. So try to select the best time that suits the load on your systems. Okay. So next session, I will show you from scratch how to use Ansible Satellite, and then how to upload the content and use this content and deploy the policy from Satellite using Ansible. Okay. So this will be the next session. Okay. Do you have any question for today?